Dang, Ansible is awesome. If what you're trying to do is to automate configuration across multiple hosts in a network, well then forget about all those other programming languages. Ansible's what you want. Much shorter learning curve, purpose-built for what it does. And in this video, we're going to demystify all the parts of the Ansible playbook. Before you know it, you'll be reading and writing these things like a champ, so let's get started. Now, first things first is that playbooks are written in YAML. And you're going to see all these dashes and colons and indentations. I want you to just put the pause button on that for the moment. We will be explaining the significance later. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to pretend to make a playbook that automates doing something that Ansible will never be able to do, building a birdhouse. You'll see why in a second. So there's my name of the project we're about to start. And these are my two buddies, John and Paul. They love birds. I want to build them bird houses. So they are the ones who are going to get this finished product. Now, to make a birdhouse, there are certain things that you have to do in a certain order in order to carry them out. Let's call each part of this process a task. And let's just give these tasks names. So first, we'd need to cut wood to size. Then we would have to assemble those pieces with nails. And then we would need to paint the birdhouse. Now the thing is that these are listed in the order that you would want to do them. Like, this would be super stupid. Like, let me, nail all the pieces together and then I'll paint it these big, 2x4s and then I'll cut it to size. Like, no, that's super dumb. You definitely want to make sure you're doing your tasks in the correct order. And here's the cool thing about Ansible. It is programming for people who aren't programmers. Just like this is how I would automate building a birdhouse if I wasn't a carpenter. I would just simply have to pick the right tool for the job and then let the job handle itself. For instance, if I need to cut wood to size, what tool do I need? I need a saw. If I want to assemble pieces with nails, that's a hammer. If I need to paint something, I'll reach for a paintbrush. What you're seeing here are what we would give as examples of modules. So for every task, there is going to be a module. And a module is a pre-written tool that can do the job for you. The saw has sawed 1,000 times. The hammer knows exactly what it's doing. All that these modules need from you are instructions. What do you want, boss? How do you want that wood there cut? For instance, suppose I want length 12 inches, width 6 inches. That's what I've got here on the screen. But here's the thing. We do need to bump that 2 spaces over to the right. This is that indentation I was talking about. Because what we're looking at here are parameters. Parameters are instructions to the module on what it is the module is supposed to do. And here are some more, non-realistic examples of parameters that we might have for a hammer, 1.5-inch nails that are galvanized, and for a paintbrush, what color is the paint, and how many coats do I want to put on it. So tasks outline what it is you're trying to accomplish, modules are what do the work for you, and parameters are where you get to provide instructions, how do you want the module to act. Now, what's up with all these dashes we're seeing everywhere? Thing is, they are not randomly placed. Dashes in YAML mean item in a list. And the thing about lists is that there's a first item on the list and then there is a last item on the list. So these dashes are significant. For instance, Ansible allows to configure multiple hosts at the same time. Here I've only got 2, John and Paul. If I had like 100 hosts, Ansible would not be able to work on 100 machines at once. It would work on 5, then 5, then 5. But point is that who are the first folks to get their birdhouse built? First John, then Paul, and then, 3rd, 4th, and 5th, right? Then 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th, and 10th. So the order matters. And like we already said, the order of these tasks matters. So notice that there's a dash in front of each like block there. That means that, hey, our first task is saw the wood, second task, hammer the nails, third task, paint the birdhouse. But then there's this dash up here at the very tippy top. And I don't want to explain that just yet because we need to take a step back. The whole thing that you're looking at here where we are saying that both John and Paul are going to have these 3 tasks executed against them, That is called a play. A play is just a list of tasks that are being executed against a host. But let's take another step back. That's just one play. You can put multiple plays together, chaining them one right after another. And do you notice what each and every one of those plays has in front of them? A dash, right? Which means that if I was going to run these two plays, that first play is the one that was going to go first, and then the second play, which is making clay pots for old George and Ringo, would run second. You can put multiple plays together inside of the same document, a YAML file that's called an Ansible Playbook. And Playbook is just the catch-all term for the file that Ansible reads and executes. Okay, so now that maybe we've gotten a little bit more of an understanding of all the nuts and bolts of what a playbook play task looks like, let's take a look at a real example of one. This is a play where we want to update a configuration file, and then we want to restart the service to make sure that that kicks in. Here we're using the copy module, where the parameters source and destination say pick up this file from here, pop it down in that destination there. And then this task, which uses the service module, will target the Nginx service and then restart it. We would kick this off by typing the command Ansible-playbook, followed by the file name. But with this particular play, this is likely the error that you would see. And Ansible is color-coded. Whenever you see red, well, that's fairly obvious. Red means error. And you will get a lot of errors with Ansible. So just get used to that now. But if we look at this particular error, it says that permission denied. Oh, we were trying to copy a file in a protected location. We didn't have the right privilege to do that. Therefore, this is a great opportunity to show you about keywords. Keywords are key value pairs that change the way that a task or play or other types of objects like blocks and roles, which we won't talk about in this video, about how those things work. For instance, become true means that, hey, when you run this task, become root. So if we added that keyword and we ran this playbook again, this is what we would probably get. A yellow output that says changed. Yellow in Ansible, you know, color palette means that a change has occurred. And there are lots of other colors for lots of other things too, which we, you know, we won't use as examples. And there are lots of other colors out there too, like green means that no change has occurred. Blue might mean that we skipped this task. And you can change these colors if you happen to have color blindness or have other preferences, but these are the default. So now that our playbook isn't failing out, it will actually be able to get to that second task where it will restart Nginx. And it will work, but here's the problem. Every single time you run this playbook, that task will restart Nginx, even when it's not necessary. Ansible is very good and very focused on item potency, which means if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Leave it alone if nothing needs to be done. But with this particular module, we do need some other method of saying this is when you should restart. And oh hey, here's another keyword. When. What this is doing is that it is looking through dot notation there, you can see, from the Ansible facts variable, slice out the Nginx service, check its state, and if that state is equal to running, then you should run this task. And if it's literally anything else, don't run this task. But yeah, that kind of begs the question, what the Ansible facts, where'd that come from? Did Ansible magically gather information about my host and the state of its services? Heck yeah, it did, because there is another keyword that is by default set to yes at the top of your plays. That is gather facts. And when gather facts is set to yes, it means that Ansible is going to gather system info about any hosts that you're working with. It's usually to have gather facts turned on, because if you don't, tasks like the bottom one with service would fail, because when it tries to look up those Ansible facts and it doesn't have them, well, then your playbook's gonna error out. So unless you know for a fact you don't need any information gathered about your host, leave gather facts turned on. Now, Ansible has come a long way since its inception. That previously, all it really was used for was to automate the configuration of Linux machines. But nowadays, you can use Ansible to configure Windows machines, still Linux machines, network devices, even cloud environments, just to name a few. And what's really nice is there's very little difference in like the layout and approach to how you'd write a playbook for any of these different platforms. The main difference is going to be, how does Ansible connect to each of these different types of platforms? All right, vocabulary time. Control node is the term for you, your computer, the machine that is running Ansible. And all these other machines here that are the Windows, Linux, cloud, and network devices, those are all managed nodes. Those are the machines that are going to be configured by Ansible. And what your control node is going to do is that it's going to establish contact with any host that you tell it to. But what's tricky is that all these different types of platforms have different means of being connected. Fortunately, you don't need to worry about that. All you need to do in your playbook is to make sure that you are specifying the correct connection plugin. So if your hosts are Windows machines, then you would use WinRM. If you're talking to Linux, SSH. If you're talking to a network device, even though that's also an SSH connection, this uses something called network CLI. And it seems sort of weird, but if you're trying to reach a cloud environment, the connection type is local. If you're interested in seeing videos on how to make Ansible interact with cloud environments, drop a comment down below and we'll take a look at that at a later date. So there you have it, gang. You now understand enough to follow roughly 90% of all playbooks that are out there. Sure, there's all sorts of really fancy other stuff like roles and handlers, and those are all great, and we can cover those in future videos. But once you master these fundamentals, you're well on your way to mastering Ansible. Speaking of which, if you are tired of messing around and you're looking to actually get proficient with Ansible, make sure that you click that link down inside of the description. Alta 3 Academy has an Ansible environment with virtual nodes for you to play with, as well as labs, an AI coach, and videos featuring me. And you can get a 3-day trial absolutely free. Best of luck with your Ansible endeavors. I'll see you next time.